You're listening to Psych with Mike. For more episodes or to connect with the show with comments, ideas, or to be a guest, go to www.psychwithmike.com. Follow the show on Twitter at Psych with Mike or like the Facebook page at Psych with Mike. Now, here's Psych with Mike.
Welcome into the Psych with Mike library. This is Dr. Michael Mahan, and I am here with my friend and colleague, Mr. Brett Newcomb.
Hello, how are you?
I'm doing well. So I have heard this said on many podcasts, and so I am going to say it as well. If you listen to Psych with Mike and you think that there is something worthwhile being presented in the show, then tell a couple of friends about Psych with Mike and encourage them to listen. We feel like that what we're doing is successful and important. We see that we are increasing our listenership. And so if people agree with us, then I would encourage them to share the show.
We feel like we are, and the numbers show that we are.
Yeah. So
so we're playing in reality.
That's right. Well, hopefully, hopefully we're not psychotic.
Well, if the numbers show, it doesn't matter. I mean, psychotic people have followings too. You want to talk about some of the...
Oh, so I have so many clients that follow podcasts. I mean, because podcasts now will allow anybody to do whatever they want, and there are actually in my opinion, alarming number of podcasts that focus on serial killers and deviant behavior, and people listen to those.
I've had so many clients through the years that are obsessed with literature on serial killers. And my anecdotal perspective is that most of those have pretty chronic abuse histories. But that's a reflexive judgment. It's not analysis. Mm-hmm. But I've seen so many people that just know so much about all the serial killers. It's frightening.
Well, and then they want to come to therapy and ask me, is that a problem? How do you respond to that?
That there are serial killers out there?
That there are serial killers out there, that there are podcasts that are have high listenerships, whether how to be one or not, but just that cover the subject, and then you are devoted to it. I mean, I don't know at what level I'm supposed to identify that as pathologic, but...
Well, and that's always the question about anything. Is it, is your interest in or focus on a particular thing a good thing? Is it a legitimate thing, or is it pathological? And the answer to the question is, how much does it interfere with your ability to function, your daily life?
Right.
So if you're engaged in or preoccupied with any focal point, and we'll talk about today's topic in just a minute because there's a lot of engagement preoccupation about it. The question is your investment pathological? Does it do you damage, or does it damage your relationships? And how can you find a way forward, maybe to maintain your interest in it, but without it being disruptive or damaging, or to drop your interest in it so that it's not disruptive and damaging? So those are the questions.
Right.
The topic today is, why didn't we have sex last night? It's an article that you found that you elucidated some research that tries to explain the differences in the way women answer that question and the way men answer that question. And the article, if I absorbed it correctly, says that women often say they didn't have sex last night because the children were around, there were jobs that needed to be done, the laundry needed to be finished, so they were tired, their partner wasn't interested, or more honestly, and maybe that's a masculine interpretation, they weren't interested for all these combination of reasons. Men usually say, when asked that question, my partner wasn't interested. So we wanted to talk about the article, and we wanted to talk about whatever random thoughts we had in response to it.
So if somebody came to you, to your office, and said, you know, we don't have as much sex as I would like, and you said, okay, well, why is that? And they said, well, my partner isn't interested. Your response to that would be what?
Well, twofold, because they will ask that question in sequence with another question. The first question is usually, what's normal? What's right? What's after? What are we, as I look at my relationship, where do we fall on the spectrum of appropriate? So what is normal in terms of sexual encounters in a relationship per week, per month, per year?
Mm-hmm.
And then the second question becomes, who initiates?
Mm-hmm.
And so what's the pattern of initiation? Do you signal me? Do I signal you? Do I understand your signal? Do I even recognize that you gave me a signal? Because sometimes those signals, that signaling, the cueing is so subtle.
Mm-hmm.
Couples that have a history with one another learn to read each other's body language. And so I can tell if you're irritated, mm-hmm. by the way your eyebrow goes up, or the way your lip curls, or the way your body tightens up, your shoulders are stiff, whatever. But I may not read your invitation cues or your arousal cues accurately. And so my response is to begin a discussion of how do you signal, what's your understanding of how she or he signals, have you ever discussed it in actual words, do you have an understanding, and then get into a discussion of what's your own experience as a couple. Of the pattern. Are you both happy with the pattern? Is one of you unhappy? Are you both unhappy?
Mm-hmm.
And then try to get into, well, why is that so?
Mm-hmm.
Why are you? What are you unhappy about?
Mm-hmm.
And how do you communicate about it? Because if you communicate just with body language, just with attitude, then things are not likely to be progressive.
So you actually posed a couple of questions,
yeah.
and I want to go back,
yeah,
circle back
absolutely.
And try and answer those. So the first thing was, I had asked you, if somebody came to your office and said, my partner wasn't interested.
Right.
My response to that is, well, did you ask them?
Okay.
And 99...
And you mean literally out loud?
Yeah.
Can we have sex tonight?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I've never had anybody say yes, and my partner said no. And so what I see in the couple dynamic, because I think you're right,
yeah.
that people are playing off of that very habituated nonverbal dance.
Right.
You like to call that a dance, and I'm not saying
it's,
I don't.
It's
but
a kinesthetic
yeah,
dance.
But
yeah.
that's yeah. a phrase that you use a lot.
Right.
And that then what they don't do is they don't try and verify their hypothesis. I am assuming from your nonverbal communication that you are uninterested in sex. Therefore, I'm going to say to myself, you're not interested, so I can't have it. And if you were to say to your partner, and we're assuming that most of the time this is the male, and if you were to say to your partner, would you be interested in having sex? At least the reaction of the other partner, in my experience, most of the time would have been, if you had asked me, I would have said yes.
So I think that's a larger, broader counseling experience.
Mm-hmm.
When we have what I call assumptive communications
right.
as a foundation for our relationship, I assume that I know you well enough, I've been married to you for 20 years,
right.
that if I raise this topic or
mm-hmm.
behave this way or say this thing or even give you a look, that you will understand because of the nonverbal dance what I'm saying. And then I assume that because I assumed you understood, I assume what your answer is going to be.
Mm-hmm.
And then I reposition myself emotionally because I've already assumed that you're going to say no.
Right.
And then I come with some attitude. I'm hurt.
Right.
I'm angry. Whatever. And you're maybe laying over there going to sleep.
And that yeah. may create a self-fulfilling yeah. prophecy because
yeah.
then your partner is reading your nonverbal behavior. If
well,
you've already assumed,
I didn't do anything.
Right. Well,
yeah.
if you've already assumed my
yeah.
partner's not interested, so now I'm angry and hurt by that,
yeah.
then she's reading that and saying, oh, he's mad at me for something. I don't even know, but apparently we're not going to have sex. I mean, so that becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, but neither one of them has verbally tried to check that out. Now, I certainly recognize that a woman could say, or the partner could say anything in the context of the therapy session, so that the partner could say, oh, I would have said yes, maybe they would have, maybe they wouldn't.
Right.
But the point is, you have to ask. It's your responsibility to ask for what you want.
Yeah.
And then to see how often you would get it. Because
right. Let's bring this right. into focus. Let's get it out in the air.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a problem? I mean, and sometimes the answer is, I would be willing to have sex if you brush your teeth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your breath smells bad.
Or
take a shower.
Or, but even if 50% of the time
right.
the person said, oh yeah, I'd be interested in sex, you'd be getting 50% more sex.
Well, that's the old Albert Ellis thing. the self-fulfilling prophecy thing about a man comes in for treatment and he's saying, I can't find anybody that'll have sex with me.
Mm-hmm.
And Ella said, who have you asked?
Mm-hmm.
Well, nobody.
Right.
You know, so he gives him an assignment. Go stand on the street corner,
yeah.
5th and Madison Avenue in New York City, and ask the first 100 women that walk by.
Back in the 60s, you could do that.
Yeah, his contention was 20 of those 100 women mm-hmm. would say yes.
Right.
Just randomly right now, let's go. Let's go somewhere and have
Well, and then his response to if you had 20 women who said yes, would you be unhappy? The guy said, no, I'd be delirious.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
Right.
Yeah, so that would solve all this problem.
Well, you haven't asked anybody, which goes back to your statement about asking.
Right. So then the second thing that you had posited, and this is something that I have actually heard in sessions, so I wanted to get your reaction to it, is what is normal?
Yeah.
And so my response to that is whatever is desirable for you as a couple.
Yeah, whatever satisfies the two of you. That's
because,
normal for you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had a client say just last night, oh, well, you know, when you haven't had sex for years.
Right.
And I was like, who hasn't had sex for years? Yeah. But that actually is some people's experience.
Or their distortion of reality. Maybe they haven't
Perhaps.
Had sex for
yeah.
weeks or months, or they haven't had it regularly. We have sex once a month, and I said, well, God, we never have sex.
Well,
we
or haven't had or sex in years. There may be people who haven't been,
I've been in a
committed long-term relationship for 35 years. So, you know, my experience of that, I can honestly say, I don't think there's been a time since I was 17 years old where I went a year without having sex. I don't think that's ever happened.
Yeah.
Okay. But that isn't everybody's experience.
Right.
And some couples I've talked to have done, you know, the 365 challenge where you try and have sex every day for an entire year. And that's a whole different argument or a conversation that, you know, there's all kinds of things fraught with that. But, so the truth is that it is whatever works for the couple, and what works for one couple isn't necessarily normal for every couple.
Well, and doesn't need to be.
It doesn't need to be.
What needs to be is a balance between the two of you where you both feel equal
mm-hmm.
and appreciated and involved. And so sometimes the conversation needs to be about mechanics. Is it painful?
Mm-hmm.
Are you too dry?
Mm-hmm.
Am I doing it right? Am I doing it the way you want to do it? Am I offering the things that you crave? And so there has to be a discussion about, well, what are the things that you crave?
Yeah.
What do you want? What can I do that makes this a better experience for you? And in my experience, most couples never have those conversations.
Right. But it has to be a conversation because we so infrequently have actual conversations about sex.
Yeah.
Everybody, you know, we had to go to school and pass a test to get our licenses to be able to practice psychotherapy.
Right.
And yet nobody ever even talks about sex. But I would argue it is one of the most foundational elements of human existence.
So part of that discussion.
We all assume that we're all great at it or that we should be.
Yeah. And part of that discussion then becomes a discussion about what is sex.
Mm-hmm.
To me, what we're really talking about is
what is intimacy. Right.
All right. I've said the same word.
Yeah.
So we need to be talking about how do you experience and define intimacy? When do you feel intimate? What does that mean? I tell them when we have these conversations, my understanding of intimacy is if I'm in an intimate relationship with you, I will take off more of my masks in your presence than I will anywhere else in the world.
Right.
But that's still not saying I'm going to take them all off.
Well, and one of the things that I do a lot with couples who are having this issue is that I will prescribe that they engage in physical touch that feels good to them and that they communicate what feels good to them to their partner, but that they don't have sex. So the rule is...
But again, you come back to the definition of sex. Is sex penetrative intercourse?
Yeah, we operationally define that.
Okay.
No intercourse.
Yeah.
And so then I say, you know, go out and try this for 2 weeks. When you come back, then we're going to talk about what that experience was. And they always come back and they say, we had great sex.
2 weeks.
No, because what happens is that when they start actually communicating about what feels good and they start actually trying to focus on that, then what ends up happening, you just end up having sex. you end up having intercourse, and you end up having really good intercourse that is mutually satisfying. And then, because really what is, I think, prevalent in our society, maybe even in the world, is that we have a lot of sex, but we don't have a lot of mutually satisfying sex.
We don't have a lot of intimacy.
And which is different than having sex. So my definition of intimacy is any relationship that has honesty, trust, and empathy, that is an intimate relationship. And most, you know, even Sternberg, who is one of the giants in this idea of communication and couples and stuff like that. And what he talked about was passion was, oh, we can't be together and not rip our clothes off and have intercourse. Intimacy was the connectedness, the friendship quality of the relationship, which doesn't have anything to do with passion. You can have intimacy and passion, but you can have intimacy without passion. So I would argue you and I have an intimate relationship. Would you agree?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so we have honesty, trust, and empathy in our relationship, even though we don't have intercourse.
So that's non-sexual.
It's non-sexual.
Right.
And so you can have intimacy
without sex.
Yep. But it's difficult to have mutually satisfying sex
without intimacy.
Yeah.
So one of the sidebar conversations that sometimes needs to happen, and I think is an outgrowth of the whole non-communicative, non-verbally communicative process, is performance anxiety on the part of the male. Mm-hmm. And men will avoid asking for sex or signaling for sex because mm-hmm. they have performance anxiety. Their assumption is that she's not going to be satisfied, that they're going to mm-hmm. be rejected, or there's going to be a level of articulated frustration that they're going to then experiences guilt or shame,
mm-hmm.
and so they want to avoid asking so that they can project onto mm-hmm. their partner, you didn't want me anyway.
Right, right.
You understand the
self-fulfilling absolutely.
Okay.
And even more, I've always believed, and this will be in the book when the book comes out, that men require a physical relationship to feel emotionally connected. And women require, and not always, so I want to make sure I'm saying...
I'm laughing about the old joke. You know, men just need a place to have sex.
Yeah.
Women need a reason.
Right. And women need an emotional connection to be able to have good sex.
Yeah.
And so we're working at cross purposes there. You know, the guy needs to have the sexual release, and that helps our hormones and everything be in a place where we feel very connected and very mutually satisfied. The woman needs the emotional relationship to be able to feel comfortable being open and allow herself to have sex. And again, I want to make sure that I'm saying up front, this isn't everybody. I'm not saying this is ubiquitous, but I'm saying just as a general rule, in my experience, that has tended to be the case. And I certainly know that that's the case in my relationship.
And there are so many other, because this is a global topic,
mm-hmm.
and we're talking about couples from different backgrounds,
yeah, sure.
different religions, different ages,
absolutely.
Different health conditions, and so you have to kind of explore
mm-hmm.
that, and you, as you explore it, you can educate, and you can offer alternative ways to understand. For instance, a lot of men, as they get older, suffer from erectile dysfunction
mm-hmm.
for lots of reasons, medical reasons, emotional reasons, performance anxiety reasons.
Mm-hmm. So plug Kathy. So Brett works with a doctor locally here in St. Louis named
Dr. Kathy Maupin. Yeah.
And they do a lot of good work in exactly that field. Yeah. And one of the things that we would always recommend is if you are in, you know, that age beyond 35 even,
yeah.
but certainly in,
40
in your 40s.
For men.
Right.
Yeah.
That and you feel like your relationship,
yeah.
but at whatever age.
Yeah.
You know, that you're experiencing this, go and get checked out.
Talk to your doctor about
exactly.
it.
Don't assume yeah. that you can't ever have satisfying relations. Go and get it checked out. There could be a simple medical reason, but in almost every case, there is something that can be done.
Yeah, almost every case. And very often what Dr. Maupin finds in her practice at biobalancehealth.com is that it's a shortage of testosterone,
mm-hmm.
that you begin with that. And if you replace the testosterone, and a lot of good things happen, especially in terms of sexual mm-hmm. performance. Also, as men age, they will experience changes in their ability to ejaculate,
mm-hmm.
volume, amount, mm-hmm. the density, and they may experience that they have what they previously experienced as orgasm, but without ejaculation.
Right.
And so they need to learn that those are equivalent variables, mm-hmm. and that you can have satisfying sex without...
And a vasectomy
yeah.
will actually influence the amount of volume of yeah. the ejaculate. And so men who have had a vasectomy will oftentimes notice that. They may not notice it when they have the procedure,
yeah.
but then
over
they'll...
Time.
Yeah.
yeah.
And so that's another physiological thing that once you understand, that's a completely normal thing that then you can get out of your head and stop.
But that also needs to be a conversation between
yeah. Yeah.
the partners in the relationship, because if I don't know that and I experience you as not being the way you used to be, then I'm going to assume it's something to do with me.
Mm-hmm.
It's in some very sub rosa level a rejection of me.
Mm-hmm.
So if I can't talk to you about that and we don't come to some understanding of what's going on, is this change normal, appropriate, is it medically required for an intervention, whatever,
mm-hmm.
then we make assumptive communications
right.
that reposition us behind defensive walls.
Right. So if we're going to land the plane, then I think what we are saying, I think we're agreeing on, is that anybody who is in a situation where they're dissatisfied or just are questioning what's going on in the sexual relationship, the first thing that we're encouraging them to do is to have a verbal conversation, not to assume that you can read the nonverbal cues
right.
of your partner, and actually sit down and talk about this. And sometimes that feels uncomfortable. Sometimes men and
almost
women
always does.
Yeah, yeah.
yeah.
And so if you find that it's difficult, you can find a professional. So, you know, as we're sitting here talking about this, I'm thinking about our friend Molly Ames, who we're going to have on the show in the very near future.
Again.
Yeah. Yeah. And this can be something that we actually bring up with her as well. But there are plenty of qualified people out there. You can talk to your medical doctor. You can talk to a counselor. You can find a qualified sex therapist. But the point is, don't assume that it's a lost cause if you haven't had the conversation.
Parallel tracks. Better communication. Focus on intimacy rather than focus on sexual performance
yes.
as you define sex.
Absolutely.
So if we have better communication about what we're experiencing, not projective assumptions.
Right.
And if we improve our level of intimacy, our experience has been, our recommendation is, your sexual satisfaction
right.
will increase.
Well, I think the intimacy is a key. I mean, I think that any
But that's
couple,
not going to happen without communication.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But
so,
any couple that improves their intimacy
right.
is going to have a more satisfying physical relationship, whether that is regular intercourse or not.
Right.
Yeah. All right. So hopefully people got something out of this. If you want to get a hold of us.
Other than excited. Yeah.
Or if they got excited, that's okay too. If you guys want to get a hold of us, go to psychwithmike.com. Again, you know, tell somebody to check out the show. And the music that you hear in Psych with Mike is always written and performed by Mr. Benjamin DeClue, and I thank him for his dedication to the show. And as always, if it's Friday, it's Psych with Mike.